We also registered Rajasthan Foundation as a charitable organization with two aims. One is to provide educational scholarships to the needy students in Canada, and if possible outside Canada within the framework provided by DCRA, and also to support and help registered charities in Canada and internationally. Now, without taking further time, I will request today's chair, Raj Kothari, to give his opening remarks.
I'm going to be brief. Oh, you want me to go there? I'm going to try and be brief so we can focus on the main comments from our guest of honor, Dr. Mehta. I have the privilege of meeting Dr. Mehta in 1995. He did not recollect that, but he was just appointed the chairman of SEBI, and subsequently in 98, and then I think it was 2001 or 2, I can't remember. But as soon as he had taken over from SEBI, he had certainly made a huge impact on the securities industry in India, and particularly pertaining to the mutual fund industry and other sectors of the financial services sector. But with that, a little introduction, and I know Naval is going to speak a lot more about Mr. Mehta, Dr. Mehta, and tell you about his achievements and what he has contributed in India, both in the professional front and in the non-professional front, i.e. the non-profit organizations. In my capacity as chair of PRANA, not only is it my honor to welcome you, but I just thought I should briefly tell you what was the reason for the foundation of such an organization. We often, and I was one of those people who always said, why do we need another organization? But we soon found out that many people of the South Asian diaspora were looking to find ways of how to give back to the country of their origins. We wanted to give something back, obviously, to the country they're taking from, to the country they adopted as their birthplace, but they also wanted to give something back to where they came from, because many of them feel that they would not be where they are had it not been for what they've taken from their home countries. So with that need and to find a avenue whereby these funds could be A, received in Canada, in a manner whereby it would be tax effective and tax efficient, and at the same time they could be disbursed with the full knowledge and in legal manner after significant and sufficient due diligence to organizations in India and in Canada or anywhere else where we believe we can make a difference. So without getting into the detailed objectives of RANA, which I think are in your papers that I've been placed in front of you, that was why RANA began. And it was a dream, I must say, of Mr. Shirley Sharma, who basically worked with numerous people in this room to make this happen. And I just want to congratulate him for having created this organization, and it is indeed my honor and privilege to be asked to preside at its first inaugural meeting. With that, I would suggest that you very closely look at the objectives. Find a way, even when you're making donations to United Way, you could actually assign your funds that you make to United Way that they can go to RANA, and you can also direct RANA to give those funds to organizations like the Jaipur Foot organization or other specific organizations in India which are registered charities and which fall within the mandate of RANA. So that is the great opportunity that many of us have now of giving funds back to where we've taken from, and of course also using this vehicle to give funds to the country that we have made our new home. And giving small amounts will make an impact. Every small thing that you give can make a difference. But imagine if the community comes together and makes a donation under the banner of RANA, which is a larger number, you will get greater attention both in the community and in the marketplace. So that is the other important thing and objective all that Rama can achieve. But I do not want to discount the fact that any contribution of any size can make a difference. So with that, again, thank you for having me here. I'm going to ask Mr. Naval Bajaj to come and introduce Mr. Mehta, and we will begin the proceedings of this afternoon.
Thank you, Kotariji, for the brief remarks. You know, it's my honor and privilege to introduce Mr. D.R. Mehta. I feel, you know, humbled for doing that type of introduction. Just a brief about him. I can go on. I think the whole evening can get, was, when I was going through what he has achieved throughout his life, I think the entire evening is less if I just keep on doing that introduction. So to just have a brief introduction, Mr. D.R. Mehta is a former chairman of Securities and Exchange Board of India. He is a founder and a chief patron of the Bhagwan Mahavir Viklang Sahitya Samiti, known as the Jaipur Fort, the world's largest organization for the handicapped in the terms of the free fitment of artificial limbs, calipers, etc. Mr. Mehta is a recipient of the Padma Bhushan, one of the highest Indian civilian award for his contribution to the social cause. Mr. D.R. Mehta joined the Indian Administrative Services, known as IS, in 1961 and held numerous important positions, initially in the government of Rajasthan and later in the government of India. Mr. Mehta served as a chairman of the SEBI, the regulator of the capital markets in India from 1995 to 2002. From 1992 to 1995, Mr. Mehta also served as the deputy governor of the Reserve Bank of India, RBI, which is the Central Bank of India. From 1974 to 1989, except for a period of the 5 years in between when he was serving the Ministry of Finance in the government of India, Mehta served the state government of Rajasthan in various senior positions as a secretary to the government in the Department of Industries, Mines and Special Programs of the Poor, EDC. He also, from 1991 to 1992, he was the Director General of the Foreign Trade, Government of India and the Ministry of Commerce. He has been always active in the social field throughout his life. He has achieved many awards, as I already mentioned, one of the highest civilian award, Padma Bhushan. Also, he was honored at the national and international levels. 2008, he was conferred with the Padma Bhushan. Mehta received the Tech Museum Award for the innovation and its use for the humanity in the Silicon Valley in the November 2007. He also a recipient of the Indian for the Collective Action Award, Diwali Behan Award, CNBC Award for the Social Enterprise, Satpal Mittal Award, and many more. So, you know, just before going on too long, I would like to invite Mr. D.R. Mehta and just acknowledge his overall a great work.
And Mr. Kothari, Mr. Y.K. Sharma, Mr. Bajaj, Mr. Buddha, distinguished members of Rajasthan Foundation, distinguished members of the Jaipur Fort organization, and friends. Let me first thank the office bearers of Rajasthan Foundation for inviting me here. I am enjoying the hospitality of Mr. Y.K. Sharma and Mrs. Y.K. Sharma. And they have overfed me. Because that today I am not in a position even to take the dinner here. But that's the hospitality of Rajasthan.
Baba Ramdev says clapping is good for the ears.
Clapping is not good for weeding or whole field. I'm extremely grateful for this opportunity. Opportunity of meeting you all. You all have come from India and have distinguished yourself in different fields. And that's the spirit of India, that's the enterprising spirit of India. I congratulate you all. Coming to the Jaipur organization, I say that it's one of my greatest privileges to be associated.
Can't hear?
And can you hear now? Okay. Can you hear? Right. I said it's one of my greatest privileges in life to be associated with Jaipur Fort. The society Bhagwan Mahavir Vikalang Sahayata Samiti, or Jaipur Fort for short, that's how it's recognized, was set up in 1975. Started in a very small way, fitting 59 limbs in the first. In the first year. And last year we fitted over 23,000 limbs. Would you believe that? Should I show the photograph? Oh. Restart?
Can you restart?
Start from the beginning. How are you there? I show a film and then make some comments. It became coordinate. And soon after that, we gave a football and he kicked it. But that's the beauty of Jaipur Fort. Functionally, it's closest to the human form, as you'll see. Light through your curtain. He got a day before, got the limb, now he's walking. All the three are and only one limb. And these boys can run a kilometer. Run over a kilometer in about 4 minutes and 2 seconds. Climb a tree. This section. When they came, they were sacked, and you see these spines. This kind of transformation. I went to Stanford University, Veteran Hospital in San Francisco, and asked them to arrange for meeting with the patient. They could produce 2 patients after 2 hours. In Jaipur alone, we get about 125 to 150 patients a day. And we have 22 branches all over the country. And of course, 2/3 of the work is done in Jaipur. very unique technology, ordinary irrigation pipe, high density polyethylene pipe, available in that color, you might also be using in your garden. We requested the company to give us a thin color. It is as strong as steel. And heated by labor, it's heated and put there on the last prepared car. Time taken is minimal, cost is minimal, and strength is more. He's our doctor, professor, head of the rehabilitation department at the University of Toronto. The laser system to ensure proper alignment. This is interesting. We have a formal MOU with the Stanford University. And we work together. And a new joint, which they call Japuni. We, of course, say that it's Stanford Japuni because it adds to our credibility. Time magazine picked this up and described this joint as one of the 50 best inventions of the world for the year 2009. We already fitted. By now, more than 4,500 people in such joints. You see how good it is. Just see this. Just like a normal foot. It's the best mechanical knee joint available to the world today. Now we are working with Stanford, development of artificial hand. That's called Jaipur hand. So we have Jaipur Fort, we have Jaipur. And then we have, this is the issue of time magazine. And it says that in the write-up, this is write-up, printed by, says that our cost is $20, of course, cost to us, not to the patient. The comparable knee joint in the United States, made of titanium and therefore perhaps not that good, cost $10,000. So 20 versus 10,000. Now this is below me. Now this lady came the same day, got the lid, and you see she walks out. Normal time taken in most of the centers in the world is 3 months. And there's no waiting list at all. Waiting list is about 1 to 3 days, that's all. Unless there's a serious complication, the number of such cases may be 1 in 1,000. Plaster of Paris, making a mold. Making a total contact socket. There was equipment for this. Foot was developed in Jaipur, developed by a team of doctors and master craftsmen in 68. And the society was set up in 1975. But in the first 7 years, not even 50 limbs would be fitted. Next 7 years, more than 10,000 limbs would be fitted. And now every year we are fitting over 20,000 limbs. Last year in 2011-12 financial year, we fitted 23,000 odd limbs, as you see. The template which has been circulated gives the details.
The total number of beneficiaries is over 1.3 million. You just see this kind of now with this limb they can go and work back in their field, in their factory, in their shop. So it's not merely giving them limb, it's also making them re-enter the economic mainstream. This is another force we are trying to make, it's fully using food. Indian Space Research Organization, which is like NASA of America, gave us this technology. We are working on it. You see the beautiful contours and the elections. See the cushion. Fast forward with no voice. Let's see the Jaipur Fort, no ordinary feat at the 80. So many people come daily. The poorest of the poor people. 95% of the people who come to us are below the poverty line. All parts of this country, being the person from Tamil Nadu. Passport, please.
For money, so the first thing I want to say is I need all your money. Let me start with that. But I would also say that a greater cause requires more money, so you know, the first cause that I think is the greatest cause is the Jaipur Fort. So clearly, they take precedence to us. I'm going to keep this very short. I want to keep running, but I'll give you a quick grasp of what ASHA is so that you understand why we do and what we do. ASHA was started in 1991 by people like me who studied in India, who took all the education and then left India to come to Canada and US. And three students got together and said, how do we give back to India? There's so much of corruption, there's so much of problems, everything is wrong. And one of them was a rag picker who was very fortunate to have been given a chance to go to school, ended up with doing his PhD in Berkeley. And they said the only way we can bring change in India is through education. And that's how ASHA came. And to give you a scope of what ASHA was, I'll share a very quick internet joke that goes around. 5 to 7 years back, a media asked Bill Gates, are you feeling threatened about Google? You know, they're coming so big. So Gates was joking to say, I feel more threatened about ASHA than Google, because ASHA has got more PhDs, Google and Microsoft put together. That's the kind of an organization we are. Do you want to go to the next one? Next slide, please. Yeah, so that's pretty much our mission statement. I can see I'm getting old because I can't read it much, but our primary objective is to catalyze socio-economic change in India through education of underprivileged children. What that mean is the Indian government focused on universal basic education, but many of us know going to a government school in certain places really means nothing. So we believe in what's called UQE, which is universal quality education. How do you increase the standard of every child so that they have equal opportunity to fight when they come out? So this is just a quick scan of what ASHA is, just to have what we are. We're absolutely a non-political organization, purely secular. We are 100% run by volunteers. And other big thing about ASHA is we have zero overheads. I think we beat you a little bit to that. Every single dollar that you donate actually goes to the project. And we have some really smart PhD students who have run some strong matrix analytics, which will actually tell you exactly where your dollar is going, which project and how that's spent. And we have zero employees. At this time, we have more than 1,000 volunteers across the globe. So this is just a gist of what we are. We have about 70 chapters worldwide, most of them are linked with universities. I think the average volunteer of ASHA is about 23 years old. So that's the kind of a profile of the organization we have. We're mostly a registered charity across the globe. We have chapters in Europe, Singapore, Australia, across. We have raised about $25 million, again, mostly efforts of graduate students who left India, came to US and other countries, who raised money and sent it back. But the greatest thing, as he was saying, it's not just sending money back, it's more about giving your human resources. One of the challenges many of you know in India is that it's not just, India has got a lot of money, it's not about it's money, it's more quality and point. So one of the initiatives we do with ASHA, every chapter, is we send volunteers back to India to work on the projects, to spend time. I go once a year, a month, to spend time with our projects so that we're not just giving them a check, we're actually working with them, sharing our expertise in helping them improve their projects. And so that's just a gist of it. We have about 400 projects going on in India. Because we are here, I thought I'll share that we have about 26 projects in Rajasthan, 9 are ongoing. When I say projects, projects could be a short term, 3 month, 1 year, but we have 9 ongoing projects in Rajasthan. And ASHA was also a recipient of the Ramin Magsaysay Award, which is considered the Asian Nobel Prize. We also have received the highest charity navigator ranking. We are ranked among the top 10 slam dunk charities in the US. It's by a group called Charity Navigator. Charity Navigator basically evaluates organizations and ranks them based on their performance. And again, I'll give you a quick round about what is ASHA Canada. We have chapters all over the world, but ASHA Canada was started in 2004. I was a student then, so a group of students came together and said, how do we do this? We started it. We're very low profile, road running. If you look at our table, it's always young people, far young, who are running the show with ASHA. And our average donation in Canada has been about $40. It's been highly unsolicited. We try to spend 80% of our time on our projects and less than 5% of our time on fundraising. And we're trying to change the model now, trying to go after some of the deep-pocketed people so that we spend more time in projects, we can send more people to work in projects on hand, not people who just have to spend from their own pocket. This is something we have done. There's no audio, so you can go to the next one. So one of the major fundraising initiatives we have is called VA, which is called Work and R. And what that simply means is we understand people are very busy in their lifestyles, especially when you're working with graduate students. You know, they gotta go for school, they gotta go work, and they have everything else too. This is a very unique program. What it means is, symbolically, donate 1 hour of your earning towards a cause. If you actually go to the website, you will see people actually giving $6.75, $9.75, and then you always have those who are giving $25, $27, $23.95. What they're doing is, they're actually giving 1 hour of the earning to a cause in India. So you are actually technically working 1 hour of your life to donate for ASHA. And so this year, in 2012, we have 13 projects, and we're aiming to raise $150,000, which will have a direct impact on 4,300 children. And you know, at another time, I'm happy to share analytics of how we do that and everything. And our focus area, every year we try and take a focus area on where we want to have an impact, because we don't want to be spread all across. We try to focus on certain areas. This year, we're focusing on children with special needs. We're focusing on rural education, and we're focusing on education in urban slums. So you can see the number of projects. One of the projects we have this year is in Rajasthan. It's a project called Seva Mandir. And Seva Mandir is actually a very, very unique project. It is actually, I'll quickly read the founder. The founder is very, very impressive. It's Dr. Mohan Singh Mehra. He's a former education minister and prime minister of the Banswara in the state of Mewar. And the concept of Seva was formed in 1930. He was an ambassador for Independent India and Vice Chancellor of Rajasthan University. And the actual work and registration was started in 1968. So this is the person who actually started Seva Mandir. And you probably may even know them. They've been doing an amazing work. And this is our focus for Seva. Seva Mandir is such a big organization. But we have taken a very strategic focus on where we think we'll have a maximum impact. And what we're trying to do is, we're looking at the place in Udaipur, and we're focusing on tribal and agrarian children and we're focusing on primary education on 1,007 children, where our cost is $50,000. So what we have done is we have looked at the migrant children. There's a lot of laborers. I can't remember the name of the district, but it starts with a P. This is where a lot of the migrant people, so people are moving around, working in construction, road work and stuff, which means their children are going with them and they don't get any education. And that's a generation which is lost. So what Asha has done is we have tied up with Seva Mandir, where we don't just provide them funding to run this project. They do a great job of running their project, but also our own volunteers, many of them who are doctorates and working with a good institution, go and spend time in training their trainers, but also working hand in hand with the students itself. You can see some pictures on some of our volunteers who are working with them. And Seva Mandir has about 171 what we call non-formal education centers. These are centers that can be mobile and move around based on the needs. They have 6 blocks in Udaipur and Rajasthan district. Asha supports 22 of these. Again, we choose where we can. We don't want to spread ourselves very thin. We look at where our strengths are, where we can have a maximum impact. We've selected 22 blocks, and those are the blocks we partner with them, A, to fund them, but also to provide our material and human resource support. And we focus on a key area of primary education of children between 6 and 14, I believe. And the project's objective, as you can see, is to ensure quality education for children between 6 and 14, to understand, to deepen the understanding of quality education and increase community demand for it. One of the things is, you know, it's easy to get a child to come to the school. It's far more difficult to keep a child in the school. I learned when I joined Asha, the number one reason why girls drop out of school, not many would guess, it's actually lack of washrooms. And now when I go and tell my donors, don't build a school, build a washroom in a school. That's the most efficient way of actually helping a child go to school. People take a step back, but that is the reality of what's happening in India, is 80% of the girls drop out when they're 12 years old because the school doesn't have a washroom. You know, if I tell this to my mom, she'd be upset, but we always say, build a washroom, that's the best way to bring Saraswati to school. And that's what it is more not being an emotional factor, but rather being a strategic factor and saying, what are the challenges? How do we work in a most efficient way? Again, these are just the product methodologies. You know, I won't go too deep, but what they do is they do non-formal education system. They work on the activity centers in government schools. A lot of the government schools don't have activities like sports or art or music or dance. We always look at avenues of how do you get a kid to come to school? How do you get the kid to stay in the school? And then comes the real part of actually how do you educate the kid. So we work with the government on the meal programs, we work with arts and programs to get them interested, and then comes the real part of actually how do you actually educate them. 3 different structures we work on. And those are some of the photos from there. So precisely, that's Seva Mandir, that's Asha. Asha is a registered charity in Canada, which means you will get a tax receipt, but however you give, whether it's in the US or India, anywhere. If you have any other questions, feel free to contact Yogesh. He'll connect you with us. We're happy to answer any of your questions. If you or your children want to go and volunteer, we have a very a structured system of taking care of it. And after this, I'll be here. If you have any questions, we're happy to chat. Thank you.
Okay, please. Okay, everybody, please, I check the light, first of all. Very good. One more, please. Yes. Action. Very nice. Great.